every place and every church and everything associated. You'll see that as we're going around. There are people who know Avila as a place much better than I do, and they're able to point out these various things that happened in Teresa's life here in Avila. What I want to say is this, and it's a kind of a general preface, I think, to everything we're going to say about Teresa. Those of you, I expect we've all wandered along these corridors now enough to have been past most of the artwork that you see, those engravings of the life of St. Teresa on the walls there, round about rooms 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, etc. Can I just say, without any disrespect whatsoever, these are not photographs or real life depictions of incidents in her life. They are idealized hagiographical presentations of Teresa, done in the early 17th century as part of the preparation for her beatification and then for her canonization. And we do have a little bit of a tendency to look at Teresa through that sort of lens. And of course, I've got it with me, that the most famous kind of interpretation of Teresa, because it is an interpretation, is of course the very famous Bernini statue in Rome, the so-called transverberation, where you see her there in ecstasy as the word of God hits her in the heart. Teresa was a very down-to-earth, practical, dangerous, subversive, risk-taking woman. She trod a very, very fine line indeed between being locked up by the Inquisition, who interviewed her, and being, what we have her today, a great mystical doctor of the church. She lived in a time which it was, I would say, impossible for a woman to adopt this role as a mistress of the spiritual life, as a teacher of doctrine, of prayer, a teacher of mysticism. Women simply didn't do it. And secondly, as I mentioned yesterday, her particular brand of prayer, if you like, the prayer of quiet, the prayer of recollection, sometimes she calls it mental prayer, was in stark contrast to the prevailing type of devotion, which was vocal prayer, external, hymns, songs, prayers, litanies, etc., etc. And her choice, if you like, for mental prayer, which was influenced by many things that she read and the life that she lived, was a very, very risky choice indeed. So the Avila of Teresa is an Avila which at the beginning of the 16th century is enjoying quite an economic boom. It is the centre of wool trade and it is the centre of rural production. All the produce of the land comes into Avila, it's sold in Avila, and people are becoming richer and richer. And the great families of Avila and the middle class of Avila, we might call it, is growing and growing and becoming richer and richer. And you will see that in Avila in the incredible decoration that you'll find in the cathedral and in other churches. It's a testimony to that growing and prosperous upper and middle class. And this is the context, the social context, into which Teresa is born. She is born into quite a, we would call it today, stratified society. Upper class, middle class, lower class, peasant. She's part of that, you might say, upper middle class would be my guess for her today. Quite a wealthy family. There is, as Peter mentioned yesterday, a very important history of ethnic mix. Not quite so much the Islam at that time, However, let's remember that for a large part of the history of Avila in the Middle Ages, there was very much that idea of being a bastion against those forces. The fact that this is a walled town, it's one of probably the most complete walled towns in Spain, and those walls date from between the 11th and the 14th century, I think also talks of what we might call a siege mentality, a kind of an assumption that we have to defend, an assumption that we have to protect. That's the kind of mental attitude that you would find. What's much more important in terms of ethnic religious mix is, of course, the Jewish background. And in Avila and in many other places in Spain, there had been quite a large debate and some quite drastic action taken against Jews in the later part of the Middle Ages, in this early modern period in the early 16th century. So much so that many Jews had become Christians in order to avoid this persecution, basically. But those conversos, the ones who had converted, were regarded with somewhat suspicious minds by people who we would call cradle Catholics, cradle Christians. Their conversion was not accepted by everybody. And sometimes there was a suspicion maybe that they weren't fully converted, or a suspicion that they didn't fully hold to Christianity. Teresa's own grandfather was one of these. She comes from a Jewish family. She has Jewish blood in her. And he too suffered and was made to do a penitential walk around the city. So she comes from that background of, yes, a lovely ethnic mix, but let's not be romantic about it. It's a mix which is very dangerous. She comes from a suspicious background. It is a place where the upper class and the middle class, in order to express their devotion, their orthodoxy, their belief, are also interested in beautifying the existing churches, founding new churches, and of course founding religious convents, friaries, monasteries as well. It's a time when there is, as you know, in Europe, by the time we get to the 1520s and 1530s, we've had the first stirrings there in Germany with Luther. Hang on to your hats, everyone, for 2017, when we celebrate 500 years of Luther. But apart from that Protestant, as it were, environment in Europe, let's not forget also that the late medieval, early modern church, even without that kick from Luther, is also interested in reform. It is not a decrepit, decaying church. It is a church that is thinking about reform. It thinks even more about it with Luther, that's for sure. But it is not a church without an idea of wanting to be a purer, a better church, a church less involved with wealth. The particular house that Teresa entered, which is behind us here on the hill, the Encarnacion, or the Incarnation House, is not strictly speaking a monastery at the time of Teresa. It's more a place where holy women, if you like, women who wanted to live a sort of a quasi-religious life, we would say, and associate themselves with the Carmelite order, gathered together to live in the same house. And I deliberately refrain from saying living in community, because that raises a whole set of expectations in our minds, I think. So coming to live together. This, actually, is the very origins of the Carmelite nuns in the order. The very first group of women who associated themselves did exactly this in Florence in the middle of the 15th century. They had a house on the wall, as it were, of our house, the Carmine Maggiore, in Florence at that time. And they were given status, as it were, in the church as Carmelites by Nicholas V in 1452 in the Bull Cum Nulla. And the reason they got that status is they didn't want to pay the taxes to the local parish. Again, let's be realistic about these things. So they said, we don't want to pay the taxes, can we be Carmelites and be exempt from taxes? So the Pope said yes. But he also said, and I also authorise the Prior General to associate, to aggregate, to make other women who are interested members of the order. So we kind of date the beginning of the nuns from that time, from the middle of the 15th century. So this house in the Encarnacion that Teresa enters is one which is very much in the tradition, the early tradition of the Carmelite nuns as they would become. It's therefore, how can I say, it's therefore not appropriate maybe to expect the sort of religious life that we associate with Carmelite nuns today, or that we associate with Teresa herself in her reforms, not appropriate to expect that in the Encarnacion when she enters. It's also inevitable from a certain point of view that these women who came together to live together tended to reflect the social classes from whence they came. And although Teresa criticises that in a certain sense and sees and is maybe a bit surprised to see this kind of these kind of gradations reflected in the community, it's not unnatural, it's not inappropriate in a way this, because it's reflecting society as it was. And the amount of prayers that were being said was again part of that desire on the part of the upper and middle classes to support these monasteries with endowments, with mass stipends we would call them, with money to support the prayer life of those women. And of course, while we today tend to think, because we're coming from a philosophical and a psychological tradition, which now places a lot of emphasis on the inner self and on our personal development and self-realization, and in a certain sense is quite an introspective way of looking at the faith, that was not common at the time of Teresa. Faith was still very much a public manifestation. Secondly, if I give you some money to say some prayers for me, and I see you just sat there praying away to yourself, how do I know you're praying for me? If you're saying out loud, you know, God bless this one and that one, and we pray for the other, etc., at least I know that you're saying your prayers for me. And there's even a case, not in Avila, I don't think, but in another part of Spain, of one particular nobleman who goes in expecting to have the mass being said for him and expecting the prayers to be said for him, and it doesn't happen, and he asks for his money back. For a reverse stipend. Because they haven't, okay guys in administration, it was a restricted donation. And they haven't fulfilled the terms of the donor. So in a certain sense, Teresa's encouragement and promotion of mental prayer, private prayer, the prayer of recollection, runs very much counter-culturally to the prevailing devotion of the day. And so for all sorts of reasons, must have seemed very strange. How do I know what you're saying to God? You might be saying something heretical to God, and I wouldn't know if you're sat there quietly praying. So it's very suspicious activity indeed. And of course, you know, once we start touching money, then it becomes really dangerous if it's calling into doubt the economic well-being of the community, that you're not falling into line, as it were. So patronage, social patterns are reflected in the monastery. And can I say also that it's not like Teresa goes in there in the 1530s and suddenly rebels against it. It takes her a good while to process the life she's living. It's a gradual process that she goes through. One thing that we we've mentioned here already, that Andros mentioned to us and was mentioned yesterday in the introduction, is of course the imagery of water in Teresa, and the famous four ways that she has of looking at prayer as watering the garden, having a channel, having a water wheel, and then finally that wonderful image of the rain simply falling and we are available to receive God's graces quite gratuitously. They're wonderful images. But I think it is very interesting to note that Avila, at the time of Teresa, as she was growing up and as she was living in the Encarnacion, was a town with water problems. The people at the top of the town had almost no water because it was all draining down, and the people at the bottom of the town, where we are basically, were flooded because there was too much water. One of the abiding concerns and preoccupations of the municipality of Avila at the time of Teresa was how to move this water around, how to get water back up the hill again so that the people at the top of the hill had enough and the people at the bottom of the hill weren't being flooded. It's therefore quite natural that when she looks for some imagery about prayer and about the effort we make and about, I suppose, the interface between humanity and nature, how can human beings control the weather? It's a question we ask in our countries quite often. It then becomes a natural image to think about the interface between humanity and God, and that gradual process by which we understand and we appreciate in our lives that it's not about us controlling God, it's not about us getting God to do stuff for us, it's about us being available for God to come into our lives as and when he wants to. So what could be more natural than using this imagery of how do we interface with nature to how do we interface with God? And so then these images of taking water out of a well, constructing a water wheel, constructing channels for irrigation would come very naturally to mind, I think. And it's a very good example of how persons' context, the life they're living, the town they're living, the problems of that town, then impinge on the spirituality and shape that person's thought. And I suppose that's also to say that when Teresa is writing and when she is considering and reflecting on prayer and other matters in the spiritual life, she's not doing this, as it were, she didn't kind of fall down from heaven with this already in her head. She's influenced by the things going on around her. So, for example, when she founds the San Jose Monastery, she, at the beginning anyway, she tries as much as possible to resist endowments and to resist people giving money. She wants to lead a life of voluntary poverty, very much in the Franciscan mold, in order to live a more genuine religious life. And she finds it extremely difficult to resist this patronage and this endowment, because it's a form of control, and she doesn't want to be controlled. When you go to San Jose, you'll see there is one chapel which is beautifully decorated with gold, and that, I believe, is the chapel dedicated to her brother. And her brothers, I think all three brothers, were very much involved in that expansion of the Hibernian, the Iberian Empire into the Americas. All three of her brothers were involved in the Americas. I think one was a governor out there, etc., etc. So very much caught up in that period of the voyages of exploration, used to call it in history, didn't we? And therefore, the one chapel, I suppose, they can't turn down for being endowed is Teresa's brother. She also refuses to vet, as you might say, or screen her candidates based on their bloodline. She does not want to go down that road of seeing which of the girls who are joining the monastery comes from some sort of Jewish background or suspect background. She wants to avoid this completely. Again, the prevailing current, the prevailing thought of the time, which was saying that these people are quite suspect. I think the final thing that I want to say as regards Teresa and her context and how she was formed, I've alluded to already. And that's the situation in Spain in the, let's call it, the middle of the 16th century. The Council of Trent is on and off, mostly off, in Rome. And the ruling family in Spain is the Spanish part of the Habsburg family. So the part that we're more familiar with, the Austrian part, that's the Holy Roman Emperor and the kings of Spain, most famously we know from our own history, Philip II, are part of that Spanish Habsburg Empire. And it is a ruling family that wishes very much to create a nation, and it wishes to create a nation with a church. A church which is loyal to Rome, a church which is Orthodox, but also a church which is very firmly under the control and under the influence of the Spanish royal family. And therefore the support that Teresa receives from Philip II is absolutely critical in protecting her from all sorts of influences and powers which would seek to destroy her, really. She's able, as it were, to harness that support in such a way that the papacy, represented by a series of very dodgy nuncios in Spain at the time, who are on and off friends with the king and not, she's able to be protected from that papal influence, and able to be protected, quite frankly, also from the Carmelite order in a general sense. Remember, at this time, there is one order, and although the prior general, Rossi or Rubeo, as he's sometimes known, was himself a supporter of reform and encouraged reform, he was under a lot of pressure from his own confreres to regard the Spanish reform with a great deal of suspicion. And I think in a certain sense he was manoeuvred into certain decisions. Can I also say with the deepest respect, it wasn't made easy for him by Teresa either. He came to an agreement with Teresa, and that she could found as many female monasteries as she wanted to, and I think four male friaries she could found. Well, she founded six. And you can just imagine the scene, can't you? You're sitting in there and saying, well, you know, mother, I said four. No, I want six, because you're a strong woman. And you know, she made an agreement, and what's the first thing she does? She breaks the agreement. And I think some of us who've had experience of trying to make arrangements with people and then them falling through kind of know how frustrating that can be. You know, I thought we'd agreed X, and now you're coming back to me again with Y. I think that's a very common kind of human experience. And you can imagine the frustration the prior general in that sense, thinking he got it under control, but in reality, of course, Teresa wasn't to be controlled. And to that extent, as you know probably from your history, gradually that reform movement within Carmel becomes more and more separate from the order itself. A separate province is established, and finally in the 1590s, 1593, a separate order is established. So Teresa, I believe, at the beginning of her time, is someone who is working within the order, within the traditions of reform of the order. And as you know, one of her key planks, if you like, of her reform was to restore the original life of the order. She saw it as one that had become, particularly in Spain, very dominated by different social classes, all these endowments, the patronage. There's a huge problem also of Carmelite friars in particular going off and getting their own jobs and doing their own thing. That's going to sound familiar to some of us. And the Pope encouraging that sometimes in order to get support. He could give prizes out of papal chaplaincies, what we call being a Monsignor today. And even Carmelites could do that. So she's living in that period where there is a great deal of concern for the reform of the order, and she wants to go back to a simpler lifestyle. She wants to go back to what she calls the primitive style of Carmel on Mount Carmel itself, as much more eremitical, but as I finish now and say, but I underline that fact, she wants to go back to that form of prayer which was much more centred on the interior progress of the person towards God, substituting many of the external devotions and much of the vocal prayer with these periods of mental prayer. And therefore, as I said yesterday, being able to reflect on the different experiences and what we would call today, probably using the language of psychology, the different stages in prayer. And some of you will be familiar, for example, with the work of James Fowler, who writes about the stages of faith as we mature in our faith. Well, I think you could apply that kind of framework very usefully to Teresa as well. And she talks about, I think, how we progress in different forms of prayer and achieve that spiritual maturity, whereby we begin to realise it's not about us and it's not about me and what I can do. It's about God and what he can do to me. So I'm going to stop there. I've just been 5 minutes over my limit. I hope that's just given you something to think about in terms of what a remarkable woman Teresa was, how much she was a risk taker, how much she was running counter to a lot of prevailing and conventional wisdom of her day, what a dangerous life she lived. Remember, none of her books were published in her lifetime. They were all published posthumously by Mr. Leon initially. Some of the books were seized by the Inquisition. Some of the books, we only have a second edition. She's all the time, if you read her stuff, when you see these little phrases like, well, I don't really know, but it seems to me that, or, you know, God forbid that I should be speaking about these subjects, comma, but. And there have been several studies of what you might call the rhetoric of Teresa, how she uses these self-deprecating terms of phrases. Oh, I'm just a simple woman. You're going to laugh when you read this, she says at one point. In order to defuse any problems that she might be going to have. She's a very, very clever woman indeed. And I would say, finally, this is really finally, very simple, very easy to read, because she hadn't got the handicap that John of the Cross had got of having studied theology. Peter.
Thank you.
No, we're going to make a move, are we?
Yeah, you don't want to take
questions. Oh, I did take questions, we've got time. I was just conscious of the time. It's all right, okay, yes.
Quick one.
Quick, yes, I beg your pardon. Sorry, yes, of course, yes.
Yeah, have to.
Her grandfather, who was Jewish, was that not known about her until later on?
Yes, I mean,
in 1947.
Yeah.
Exactly. One document was found in the archive in Biobelief by accident, and it's been completely covered up before.
But she knew that.
She knew that. It was not at all convenient for her to make that known. But you can see in her in her refusal to apply those screenings to the young girls coming in, checking on their bloodline, you can see that is, as it were, a reaction to what maybe she had known of her grandfather.
And that really surprises me, because I would think in a small community where there's strict social network and a strata, I'm really surprised that people just don't know the history of the next generation for you. I find it extraordinary. But well, there you go.
Is it fair to say that I think the revelation came through a court case about there was a family dispute over a property, and she was executor.
I spent some time when I was looking at this question, looking at the transcript of the court case, and I think it's for sale, you can buy it somewhere in Adelaide, And it's really interesting because the family, again, as Father Kim was saying, it's about tax. The family some tax relief. If you're from low minor nobility, you got exempt tax. So the brothers and her father and the two brothers, who had gone in procession round in Toledo in this penitential thing that Father Kim was talking about, they asked for exemption because of their noble status. And if you read the transcript, it starts out really well. It says the Cepedas and Almagas, they've been loyal servants of the crown, they fought in this battle, they served this king, etc., etc. And then quite fascinating, suddenly this, I think I can remember his name, Bernardo Platero was his name, he suddenly pipes up, they're not loyal, so they're all Jewish. And then you can see almost the guy this lot, they're all Jewish, they come from Toledo. They were, and then another one says, yes, they are. And exactly as you say, they also, suddenly all the voices come out. And then they have to stop the case. They say, hold on a minute, we have to now send the case to Toledo to get the official report from the Inquisition. So they all wait. And then a few months later, the thing comes, yes, these people were Jewish, they were reconciled, this horrible process that Kevin was talking about. But interesting enough, one of them didn't reconcile. One of Teresa's uncle refused to become a Christian. He remained Jewish. We don't know what happened to him. He might have gone, he probably left Spain. But then the most funny thing is, the court case goes up, and they get it. So I think, so, yeah. I mean, it is funny because they actually get it, despite all this.
With a non-disclosure clause.
The international language.
I think the secrecy success was silence, wasn't it?
Yeah.
It was just covered over by influence and violence.
And